Hey guys, welcome to Command Valley. This episode is part two of the Commander 2020 set review. In this episode, we're going to be going over the cards in the 99 of the new precons. Before we get into that, just a quick shout out to this episode's sponsor, Game Grid Lehigh. If you're in the Utah County area, go ahead and look them up. They're awesome. And also don't forget to subscribe to our channel so you don't miss all of our future deck techs on the commanders inside of the set. And you don't miss any of our future episodes. We post new deck techs every Monday. Like I said in the beginning, in this episode, we're going to be going over the new cards, not the reprints, in the 99 of the new precons. So we're going to start with black and just work our way down from there.
We're not going to be covering all of the new cards. We're not going to be covering the lands or the reprints. We're just going to be going over the new cards that we think are relevant in Commander or that we think will have some sort of an impact.
The way that we evaluate cards isn't necessarily competitive or even super jank. We just are evaluating these cards based off of our initial opinion on how they will affect our Commander meta or just how you could put these in any given deck.
So let's start off with the first one in black. We have Daring Fiendbonder. He is 3 and a black for a 5/1 with haste. Daring Fiendbonder attacks each combat if able, and for 1 and a black, exile Daring Fiendbonder from your graveyard, put an indestructible counter on target creature. Activate this ability only anytime you could cast a sorcery. So this is the first card that introduces the new keyword counters, and by exiling him from your graveyard, you can give something indestructible, or an indestructible counter. I really like this card for the fact that you can give something indestructible. It is at sorcery speed, but just having the ability to give something indestructible from your graveyard gives you a lot of options in the future to protect that commanders, big creatures, or possible engine pieces. A lot of commander decks really rely on the commander being on the battlefield, and one of the biggest parts of that is having protection in your deck to make sure that it still is on the battlefield when you need to do your strategy. Having Daring Fiendbonder in your graveyard and putting it on your commander gives him indestructible, so there's so many decks that people want to have this ability to give them indestructible. Another cool thing about it is that he is a 5/1. That's pretty impactful. 5 damage is a lot, and it eventually will die because people can't just keep taking 5 to the face every single time he attacks.
Next up, we have Deadly Rollick, which is the first card that we're going to be covering in the Lieutenant cycle. So there are 5 cards, 1 for each color, that if you control your commander, you can cast the spell without paying its mana cost. This one costs 3 and a black, but if you, like I said, if you have your commander, you can pay without paying its mana cost. It's instant speed, and you can exile target creature. This kind of seems, I'm not going to say it seems pushed, but I don't see why you wouldn't put this in any deck that's playing black. It goes well in basically any strategy. I mean, 4 mana, having to hardcast it for 4 mana is a little steep for exiling a creature, but at the end of the day, you know, I'd take 4 mana over killing an Eldrazi that's about to smack me in the face really hard. I like a lot that it says exile target creature, not destroy target creature. A lot of times people are playing creatures that you kill them, but they're just gonna reanimate it later, or they want you to kill it because when it dies, it has some type of effect, or they have other pieces on the battlefield that care about when things die, but this just exiles it. It gets it out of the game. It's not in their graveyard. They can't reanimate it later. This is a really, really good failsafe card.
Next up, we have Dredge of the Mire, which is 3 and a black for a sorcery. Each opponent chooses a creature card in their graveyard. Put those cards under the battlefield under your control. The first thing I want to note about this card is that it says each opponent chooses a creature card in their graveyard, so you're not going to be included in that. And it also says that they choose the cards that you're going to get onto the battlefield under your control. That's the reasons why it's so cheap. But the reason I really like this card is because if you're on turn 4 and people have lost their small CNC high impact creatures, you can get those onto the battlefield under your control, whether it be mana dorks like Birds of Paradise, an Azusa, Lost But Seeking, Mother of Runes, and all in all, paying 4 mana to get 3 bodies onto the battlefield, that's not a bad rate at all. Even if you're not getting the best creatures, even if you're just getting a Line of War Elves or some other small, dirtly creature, 4 mana for 3 creatures is good in any Aristocrats deck.
Next up, we have Mind Leecher, and this is the first card with Mutate that we're covering in this episode. It costs 4 black-black. It is a creature nightmare with flying, and it says, whenever this creature mutates, exile the top card of each opponent's library face down. You may look at and play those cards for as long as they remain exiled. It's a 5/5, and it costs 4 and a black to mutate. So to mutate, you have to control a non-human creature that you can target with the mutate ability, and you cast it. So you cast it, target a non-human creature that you own, and you can put Mind Leecher above or below the creature that you're targeting. The new mutated creature will have all abilities of the creature beneath it, and you use the power and toughness and the name of the card that's on top. So every time that Mind Leecher mutates, you're going to exile a top card of your opponent's library, and you can look at and play that card. I like this ability and I like the way that it's worded because even if Mind Leecher leaves the battlefield, you can still cast and play those cards because it says for as long as they remain exiled. This ability gets a lot better if you're playing more mutate cards, but even still paying 5 mana to potentially get 3 cards isn't a bad deal. It could suck and you could get lands, but it says that you can play those cards, so you can even play lands. The biggest downside to this card is you still have to have the right color of mana to cast those spells. So let's say, for example, if you're playing this in a black-green deck and you're playing against a red-blue and a blue-white and a green-black deck, a lot of the time you're not going to have the right color mana to cast those spells.
Next up, we have the card that's probably making the biggest splash in Commander. We have Netherborn Altar. For one in a black, we have an artifact. It says, tap, put a soul counter on Netherborn Altar, put your commander into your hand from your command zone. Then you lose 3 life for each soul counter on Netherborn Altar. Now, I wanted to bring Landon into this one, because we were having this discussion. How many times, Landon, would you want to use this before you think it's bad?
Yeah, I think if you use this 3 times, that's 18 life. That's a lot of life to pay, but I think that this is one of those cards where you use it twice and that should be enough for you to either win the game or restabilize yourself. I would want to play this if I'm playing a commander that has really high CMC, and if it dies more than twice, it's really hard to recast it, like Moldrotha is one, or maybe you're playing basically any legendary creature that costs more than 6, I'd probably put this in the deck.
Absolutely. I think I'd honestly put this in a deck that even has 3 or 4 mana casting commanders, because the thing is, you probably don't need to use this until it's been removed 1 or 2 times. Like, you cast it the first time, and then the next time you might have enough mana, but after that you can just start paying. You don't have to pay for it right away. You can use this as just something to get around that commander text, and that's extremely useful. The fact that it's only 2 mana and it's mono black means it can fit in any deck that has black, which I want this in my Sir Conrad. I want this in Yennet. This is honestly an amazing card.
It's nice that you can activate it at instant speed and without having to pay any mana. And if you're in a life gain deck, I really don't see why you wouldn't put this in there anyways. I mean, if you have a way of gaining lots of life or maybe even removing counters from things, yeah, it's super cool. Next up, we have Species Specialist. It is a 2 black-black human warrior, and when it enters the battlefield, you choose a creature type. Whenever a creature of the chosen type dies, you may draw a card. This is a super cool creature. I actually like it a lot, because if you're not playing a tribal deck, you can still play it, because a lot of times people that you're playing against are playing a tribal type. So you can choose one of their tribes. Or if you are playing a tribal type, you just choose one of yours. And then you can draw a ton of cards off of this depending on what you choose. If you have built your deck around a tribe, and probably humans, I mean, I don't see a whole lot of warrior decks, and a lot of warrior decks have a lot of humans in them anyway. So like if you're playing a Nigella, the Blade Blossom deck, or if you're playing a 5-color human deck, or whatever type of human deck you're wanting to play, I think that this is probably an auto-include. It's a really nice safety valve against board wipes. I think it'll make your opponents think twice about board wiping, and a lot of Nigella decks want to go really, really, really wide. So this is kind of like really nice if you're after you've dumped your whole hand, building up your board, your opponents wipe it, you're gonna get some cards back for it.
The last of the black cards, we have Titan Hunter. 4 and a black for a 4/5 creature human warrior. At the beginning of each player's end step, if no creatures died this turn, Titan Hunter deals 4 damage to that player. And for 1 and a black, you can sacrifice a creature and you gain 4 life. There is a lot of cool things about this card. First off, the fact that it can dome each opponent for 4 if a creature had not died that turn, that's very powerful. If you can get this out early, or if you can play this after a board wipe, then it's gonna hurt your opponents. And even if this goes around the table 2 times, you're racking up 24 damage that you've dealt to your opponent on 1 card. That is really, really powerful. The fact that it also can be a sacrifice outlet, and I mean, you do have to pay 1 and a black, but it can sacrifice a creature and gain you 4 life to satisfy the trigger on her, that's just very flavorful. It's got high impact on it. You can also even use this politically, because the thing is, Titan Hunter says that if a creature did not die this turn, that player takes 4 damage. So you can use your own aristocrats to kind of levy some politics against your opponents by saying, hey, if you don't want to take 4 damage this turn, like, I'll sacrifice one of my creatures to satisfy the effect, but you need to do this for me first. So yeah, there's a lot of cool things about this card. I'm excited to see this being played.
All right, getting into the blue cards, we have Crystalline Resonance. It is an enchantment that costs 2 and a blue, and it says, whenever you cycle a card, you may have Crystalline Resonance become a copy of another target permanent until your next turn, except it retains this ability. There are so many shenanigans that you could possibly do with Crystalline Resonance, so much so that, honestly, probably could talk about this card all day. What I would probably do is I would play this in a deck that wants to have another value engine piece, I would slot this in as my value engine, because you can turn this into your opponent's value engines. If your opponent has a Smothering Tithe, or a Rhystic Study, or a Mystic Remora, or Necropotence, or some really powerful enchantment artifact like a Mimic Vat, or maybe a Gilded Lotus. There are so many different like value piece engines that you could have Crystalline Resonance become a copy of. You only get it for one turn, but sometimes that's all you need. And just the flexibility of whenever you cycle a card, you're already going to want to be cycling cards in a cycling deck, so this is just a lot of extra benefit for that. I'm also sure that there are some interesting things that you could do with stacking the triggers, so cycling a card, having Crystalline Resonance becoming a copy of something, activate that card's ability while your other cycling card is on the stack, and then you immediately change it. I'm sure that there are some super cool things you could do with that, so.
Next up, we've got Decoy Gambit. 2 and a blue, an instant. For each opponent, choose up to one target creature that player controls, then return that creature to its owner's hand, unless its controller has you draw a card. Now this doesn't seem very great at first, but honestly, think about it this way. If you're playing in a blue control deck, if you're playing something that you're waiting to cast something else, whether you're playing like a Pharah, you know, a Yennet deck, Temsis, this is a really good card to have at the beginning of the game, because the thing is, you're not playing that many creatures, so you can essentially give your opponents the choice like, hey, you wanna let me draw cards or you wanna bounce your creatures? And either way, it's gonna turn out well for you. You're either gonna be able to draw 3 cards, bounce 3 creatures, or a mix of both. And honestly, I'd be happy with any of those results. That's why I really like this card. I'm gonna quickly take the next one because I'm really excited for this one. It's Aeon Frolicker. For 2 blue-blue, we have a 5/5 creature elemental otter. It's got flying. When it enters the battlefield, if you cast it, target opponent takes an extra turn after this one. Until your next turn, you and planeswalkers you control gain protection from that player. This is a super political card. It's got political drip all over it. When I first saw this card, I thought it would go perfect in my Temsis deck. Because the thing is, one of the biggest problems with Temsis is that I'm struggling to take out 3 opponents. But with this card, if I can give somebody else a turn to wipe out an opponent, make a deal like, say, hey, I'll give you this extra turn, but take out this guy, then that's one opponent less for me, and now I can more smoothly win the game with Temsis. I wouldn't necessarily, I'd say I'd play this in every blue deck, but I definitely would play this in a lot of blue decks. It's a fun card. Your opponents are going to have fun with it. It's very political, and I honestly think this is a good design political card.
All right, next up we have Ethereal Forager. It is an elemental whale that costs 4 blue-blue. It has Delve, which says each card you exile from your graveyard while casting this spell pays for 1 generic mana. It has Flying, and whenever Ethereal Forager attacks, you may return an instant or sorcery card exiled with Ethereal Forager to its owner's hand. This goes super well in a lot of Spellslinger decks. I personally, that's one of my favorite archetypes. I love Spellslinger decks, and one of the biggest problems with Spellslinger decks is you are super creature light. So being able to play a creature that not only has a pretty solid body at 3/3 and some good evasion, but also can return instants and sorcery that you exile with it, I like that a lot. I really don't see why you wouldn't want to play this in a Spellslinger deck.
Next up, we have probably one of the best blue cards that has come out in quite a while. We have Fierce Guardianship. For 2 and a blue, we've got an instant. It's the blue cycle of the Lieutenant cards. If you control your commander, you may cast a spell without paying its mana cost, counter target non-creature spell, and it's 2 and a blue. So if we know anything about Magic, we know that counter spells, even if they're conditional counter spells, are highly sought after. We look in Modern Horizons, we just had Force of Negation, and that is super high in price right now. I expect this card to go way up in price and retain and stay expensive, because it really is just an amazing card. If you are playing a blue deck and you use your commander pretty consistently throughout the game, definitely put this card in. It is an amazing slot, and again, probably the best, in my opinion, of the Lieutenant cycle.
Next up, we have Tidal Barracuda. It is a fish that costs 3 and a blue, and any player may cast spells as though they had flash, and your opponents can't cast spells during your turn. It's also a 3/4. This is a super interesting card. It seems like a lot of cards that they've been printing in Commander 2020 have a lot of political stuff stapled onto them, and this is no exception. Being able to give all of your opponents flash with the condition that they can't do anything during your turn sounds like a political deal that I might try and strike when I cast a spell like this. I think that this is a super good card in most blue decks. Right now, the only things that we have that give your spells flash are Leyland of Anticipation and Vedalken Orrery. And just having a third card like that, increasing that redundancy, is super sweet.
Next up, we have Curious Herd, which is 3 and a green for an instant. Choose target opponent. You create X 3/3 green beast creature tokens, where X is the number of artifacts that a player controls. So if we put it into perspective, let's look at the floor and the ceiling, right? You probably at the worst, want to cast this when your opponents, on average, maybe at least have two artifacts. And you're creating 2/3/3 green beasts, that's 6 power for 4 mana. That's not great, it's not terrible, but think of the ceiling. What if your opponent has a smothering type? What if they have 7 treasures? What if they're playing a lot of mana rocks? What if they're playing an artifact deck? You could potentially get 10 3/3s for 4 mana. I think that is a really good deal for this card, especially since it's already an instant, which means you can use it on anybody's turn. A lot of flexibility, a lot of potential. Love this card.
Next up, we have Glade Muse, which is a beast that costs 2 and a green, and it says, whenever a player casts a spell, if it's not their turn, that player draws a card. I'm a little skeptical of this card. I think that you're only going to want to play this in a deck if you know for a fact that you can take more advantage out of this card than your opponents. If you have ways of playing several cards on other players' turns, then it's definitely worth playing. Maybe if you're playing a Rashmi deck where you're wanting to be playing on your opponent's turns anyways to take advantage of Rashmi's ability, or if you're in a blue-green deck and you have ways of making it so your opponents can't draw extra cards, like Narset, Parter of Veils, or if you're in Sultai and you're playing Notion Thief. But otherwise, I think the bottom line is, I probably wouldn't play this unless I know for a fact that my opponents can't take as much advantage of it as I could.
Next up, we have the green cycle for the Lieutenant cards. It's Obscuring Haze. For 2 and a green, we have an instant. If you control a commander, you may pay the spell without paying its mana cost. Prevent all damage that would be dealt this turn by creatures your opponents control. This is very flavorful for green. Normally, I would not include a card that's 2 and a green to basically just fog. However, the fact that you can pay this without paying its mana cost if you have your commander leaves you with some flexible options. If you're tapped out and you've swung out and all your creatures are tapped and you basically are saying to your opponents, that was it, I'm probably dead, and you can cast this when they attack you and basically just take the game back, that's very powerful. Never underestimate being able to pay things without paying their mana cost. Even though this is essentially just a fog for your opponents, an overcosted fog at that, being able to cast this without paying its mana cost is extremely powerful, and I would not underestimate this card. This is going to be a card that I'm going to be thinking about whenever I'm playing against somebody that has green and they're tapped out.
Next up, we have Sawtusk Demolisher, which costs 4 green, and it has a mutate cost of 3 and a green. It is a creature beast. It's a 6/6. It has trample, and whenever this creature mutates, you can destroy target non-creature permanent. Edge controller creates a 3/3 green beast creature token. I would probably only play this in a deck that has somewhere around 8 to 10 mutate cards. Otherwise, I think that might be a little overcosted for its ability. I think there are better cards in green that can get rid of a more flexible variety of cards. But I think this gets really, really, really good the more mutate cards you have.
Next up, we've got Selective Adaptation. For 4 green, we have a sorcery. Reveal the top 7 cards of your library. Choose from among them a card with flying, a card with first strike, and so on for double strike, death touch, haste, hexproof, indestructible, lifelink, menace, reach, trample, and vigilance. Put one of those chosen cards into the battlefield, the other chosen cards into your hand, and the rest into your graveyard. So this is another one of those cards that has a very high ceiling. If you can manage to get 5 or 6 cards off of this, that's a really good rate for 6 mana, especially because you can put one onto the battlefield. However, if you whiff and you only get 1 card, that's 6 mana to put 1 card onto the battlefield. That may not be a great rate, but still, the ceiling is very high on this card. If you're playing a deck that wants to have a lot of keywords in it, such as the new Cathedral deck, then this is going to be an amazing card.
Next up, we have Slippery Bog Bonder. It is a human druid that costs 3 and a green. It has flash and hexproof, and when it enters a battlefield, put a hexproof counter on target creature. Then, move any number of counters from among creatures you control onto that creature. If nothing else, if the only counter that you have is the counter being put onto another creature by Slippery Bogbonder, I don't think it's really that bad. Again, if you are playing a deck that relies heavily on your commander, being able to give your commander hexproof is something that's probably worth it. But this card just gets better and better the more creatures you're playing with counters on them. So if you're in a blue-green proliferate counters deck, or maybe a Traxa, or any deck that cares about lots of counters of any type, this card is probably a auto-include.
SWAT! Next up, we have Deflecting SWAT, which is the red version of the Lieutenant cycle. It's 2 and a red for an instant. If you control a commander, you may cast a spell without paying its mana cost. You may choose new targets for target spell or ability. I think this card is very, very powerful. The fact that you can target abilities as well. It means that you can have a lot of flexibility even if you're tapped out to hopefully save you from something or maybe just change a play into your favor. A really unique way of using this card is you can actually use this against a counterspell. What you do is that you choose new targets for the counterspell when you cast this, have the new targets be deflecting SWAT to be able to save your plays or somebody else's plays that benefit you.
Next up in red, we have Fireflux Squad. It is a human soldier that costs 3 and a red. It has haste, and whenever a Fireflux Squad attacks, you may exile another target attacking creature you control. If you do, reveal cards from the top of your library until you reveal a creature card. Put that card onto the battlefield tapped and attacking, and the rest on the bottom of your library in a random order. This is a pretty unique card. It seems like a lot of cards that we're getting in the Commander set and also in the Standard set, which we'll cover later, have a lot of random aspects to it. A lot of cards deal with the top of your library or digging in your library to find something specific, and this is one of those cards. I'm always super hesitant in playing cards like this. Unless I know for a fact that I can get something off of it and something good every single time, I probably wouldn't play it. Also note that it puts the creature onto the battlefield tapped and attacking as well, so that's really cool. But at the same time, it won't get any attack triggers if that creature has it, because it will already be attacking and it won't see, the ability won't trigger off of this. But this is one of those cards that has a super, super, super high ceiling and also a pretty, pretty, pretty low bottom. I think if you're playing this, let's say in a red-green deck and you have Eldrazi's in your deck, but you also have Mana Dorks, you could either get an Elvish Mystic or you get an Eldrazi Titan. It just kind of depends. But it's nice that it has haste and it can activate its ability the turn it comes out.
Next up, we have a red artifact, Lava Brink Floodgates, which is 3 in red for an artifact. You can tap it to add 2 mana, which already...
Red.
This is... Wow. Okay. At the beginning of each player's upkeep, that player may put a Doom counter on Lava Brink Floodgates, or remove a Doom counter from it. Then if it has 3 or more Doom counters on it, sacrifice Lava Brink Floodgates. When you do it, it deals 6 damage to each creature. There's a lot to this card, so let me go ahead and break it down for you. First of all, we have a 4 mana artifact that can ramp in red that gives you 2 mana, so you can use it the turn it comes out. The downside, too, is that your opponents can choose to put Doom counters on it, or remove Doom counters on it, and then if it has 3, it blows itself up and it deals 6 damage to each creature. So it's saying, hey, if you want to put Doom counters on this, when you have 3, it's going to essentially wipe the board. I'm going to guess that it's going to be rare for Lava Brink Floodgates to blow up. Honestly, seeing somebody have a mana rock for 4 that gives them 2 mana doesn't seem like that much of a big deal. I don't want 6 damage to happen to all of my creatures, unless I'm not playing a creatures deck. So that's why I really like this card. It's well designed. It's a ramp artifact for red, which red definitely wants more of, and I expect this to stick around 98% of games.
Next up, we have Molten Echoes, which is an enchantment that costs 2 red. And as it enters a battlefield, choose a creature type. Whenever a non-token creature of the chosen type enters a battlefield under your control, create a token that's a copy of that creature. That token gains haste. Exile it at the beginning of the next end step. Like we saw earlier with Species Specialist, this works in a deck that wants to play a lot of the same creature type, or it works against a deck that has a lot of the same creature type. That flexibility is really nice to have. As for the card itself, it's very contemporary to the Flame Shadow Conjuring, which does very similar for the same amount of mana, except for you have to pay a red on Flame Shadow Conjuring to get the token copy of the creature that's entering the battlefield, and you can do any creature, not just the chosen creature type. However, if I were to put this in one of my decks, I would put it in some type of human tribal deck or some type of tribal deck, because that's probably the only way that you can rely on it consistently every time that you draw it. But it could do a lot of really cool shenanigans if you're maybe playing like a beast tribe that has a lot of big beasts, or a big titan tribe that making a token copy of a creature is super good in that deck. Next up, we have Spellpyre Phoenix, which is a phoenix that costs 3 red and red. It's a 4/2 with flying, and it has, when Spellpyre Phoenix enters the battlefield, you may return target instant or sorcery card with a cycling ability from your graveyard to your hand. And at the beginning of each end step, if you cycle 2 or more cards this turn, return Spellpyre Phoenix from your graveyard to your hand. I actually like this card a lot more than I thought I did before. One of the problems with cycling is sometimes you're forced to make a choice. When you start to have fewer and fewer cards in your hand, and the cycling cards in your hand don't seem very relevant right now, a lot of times you're forced to cycle those cards to draw cards to help you out of the situation that you're in. And then later down the road in the game, you really wish you hadn't cycled those cards away, because now those cards became relevant. Spellpyre Phoenix gives you the means of being able to safely cycle away cards now, and use the Phoenix to bring those cards back into your hand later in the game when those cards become relevant.
Next up, we've got Surly Badgesaur, which is 3 and a red for a 3/3 creature badger dinosaur. Whenever you discard a creature card, put a +1/+1 counter on Surly Badgesaur. Whenever you discard a land card, create a treasure token. When you discard a non-creature, non-land card, Surly Badgesaur fights up to one target creature you don't control. It feels like a red version of Waste Not. So if you're playing a black-red deck that is focused on discarding, then Surly Badgesaur is an amazing fit. Even the new commander, Brawlin and Chabrez, with Brawlin, when you're discarding cards and pinging your opponents, you're also getting more advantage off of that. So if you're ever trying to discard cards, you're cycling cards, this goes really great in Anya Falconwrath. Being able to just get some more advantage off of discarding your cards is extremely useful.
Moving into white, we have Avenging Huntbonder, which is a human warrior that costs 3 a white and a white, and it's a 3/3. It has double strike, and whenever Avenging Huntbonder attacks, you put a double strike counter on another target attacking creature. For 5 mana, for a creature that doesn't have haste that wants to attack to get the value out of it, it might be a little low impact. There are probably better cards that you could put in a deck, but if you are in a heavy aggro deck, maybe a Naya aggro deck, or a deck that wants to hit really hard, this might be worth playing, especially if you have ways of giving your creatures haste. It's nice that the double strike counter stays on that creature. It is unfortunate that the creature also has to be attacking, but it could be a way of maybe you have another creature that needs to attack every turn and you don't want it to die, so you can give it double strike as a way of keeping it from dying. Maybe your opponent has a blocker. I think that there are fringe places for it to be in, but you really have to want it.
Next up, we have Call of the Coppercoats, which is 2 and a white for an instant with Strive. This spell costs 1 and a white more to cast for each target beyond the first. And it says, choose any number of target opponents. Create X11 white human soldier creature tokens where X is the number of creatures those opponents control. This card is really, really good. This is an amazing token maker that's gonna slot into every token making deck that I can think of. The fact that it's got utility, even if your opponent only has 2 creatures, you're still making 2 1/1s for 3, which is a pretty average rate for those kind of cards. But say if your opponent has 10 creatures and another opponent has 7, if you can pay 5, you can make 17 1/1 human soldiers. That is a really, really high floor, especially in Jarena, which is the human face commander for the new precons, the Ruthless Regiment commander. This is probably, I'm going to say, one of the best cards in that deck.
Next up, we have Cartographer's Hawk. It is a creature bird, 2/1, that costs 1 and a white. It has flying, and when Cartographer's Hawk deals combat damage to a player who controls more lands than you, return it to its owner's hand. If you do, you may search your library for a Plains card, put it onto the battlefield tapped, then shuffle your library. Now, there's another card later down on the whitelist that we're going to talk about, but a lot of the things that we say about Cartographer's Hawk also apply to that other card. Both of these cards were promised to us a little bit earlier that we would get cards in white that have mana ramp. I do appreciate that they did give white some form of ramp, and that this ramp, it's good, it's not always reliable, and it's not ever going to be able to push you ahead of your opponents because you're always going to have to be behind your opponents in land count to get that mana ramp. So it never brings you above the status quo, it just brings you to it. And I would argue that white doesn't need mana ramp as badly as it needs card advantage and card draw. A lot of times when I'm playing a white-green deck, I have green to rely on for the ramp. I would like to have ways in white to get more card draw. But again, it's nice to have something that at least has the potential of putting lands into play. And if you are in a white-red deck that doesn't really have card draw or mana ramp, this is a super nice thing to have.
Next up, we've got Dismantling Wave, which is 2 and a white for a sorcery. For each opponent, destroy up to 1 target artifact or enchantment that player controls. And then you can cycle it for 6 white-white. And when you cycle Dismantling Wave, destroy all artifacts and enchantments. So that's a really high cost to cycle something to destroy all artifacts and enchantments. I mean, that's 8 mana, that's a lot. But think about it, for 3 mana, you can destroy 3 different artifacts and enchantments. That is super, super good at turn 3. If your opponents are playing mana rocks, and you cast this and just destroy their mana rocks so they're not ramping, and even late game, you can destroy those high impact enchantments and artifacts. This is incredibly useful, it's got a lot of utility, and you can use it early or in the late game.
Next up, we have the 5th and final Lieutenant free spell from this set. It's Flawless Maneuver. It's an instant that costs 2 and a white. And if you control Commander, you may cast this spell without paying its mana cost. Creatures you control gain indestructible until end of turn. I really, really love this card. A lot of decks that I build, especially with white, make a lot of tokens and a lot of creatures, and one of the worst things to have happen is you've dumped your entire hand, built your entire board, and your opponent is sitting over there all smug because on their turn they're just going to wipe the board. Well, you can throw this card right in their smug face because you're just going to say no to that.
This is White's way of saying absolutely not.
Something that I think is hilarious about all of these lieutenant cards is it says if you control a commander. You don't even have to control your own. If you are playing some type of deck that can take control of other people's cards and other people's creatures, you can still cast, and you take your opponent's commander, you can still cast these spells. I only think that's relevant because I have a white-blue Afara deck in which I play a couple of ways of stealing my opponent's commanders. it's really gross. Agent of Treachery is a disgusting magic card.
Especially blinking it multiple times in one turn.
Oh yeah, yeah, it's disgusting. If you're playing white, I really don't see how you would not want to play this card. You'd have to really justify not playing this card.
Next up, we have Herald of the Forgotten, which is 6WW for a 6/6 creature cat beast with flying. When it enters the battlefield, if you cast it, return any number of target permanent cards with cycling abilities from your graveyard to the battlefield. There's not much to say about this card. It's just a very powerful card in a cycling deck. So if you're playing a cycling deck such as Gavi the New Cycler or any other deck where you're cycling cards a lot, then this is definitely going to be one of your finishers or at least one of the cards that's going to propel you to a winning state in the game.
Next up, we have Verge Rangers, which costs 2WW for a human scout that's a 3/3. It has first strike. You can look at the top card of your library anytime, and as long as an opponent controls more lands than you, you may play lands from the top of your library. So, like I said earlier when I was talking about the Cartographer's Hawk, this is the other card that I feel is pretty good for a white deck. Like I said, this never puts you ahead of your opponents. It only brings you up to where your opponents are at. And I guess that it is nice that just one of your opponents has to have more lands than you do. A lot of times in a lot of games, somebody is going to be playing green and is going to be casting a lot of Harrows, Farseeks, Rampant Growths, Cultivates, Kadama's Reaches. So likely, I'd probably say 70-80% of the time, Verge Rangers is going to get you probably at least two or three lands off the top of your library, which in white, that's pretty good. I would say Verge Rangers is probably more efficient than Cartographer's Hawk. I like Verge Rangers a lot more. I would probably play it in a lot more decks.
Next up, we're going to move on to the artifacts. We only have a couple here, but the first one is Manascape Refractor, which is 3 generic for an artifact that enters the battlefield tapped. Manascape Refractor has all activated abilities of all lands on the battlefield. You may spend mana as though it were mana of any color to pay the activation costs of Manascape's Reactor's ability. I'm sorry, Refractor's abilities. So if you are playing a budget deck and you are sitting in a group and your friends are playing a lot of lands that are extremely powerful, maybe they have a Gaia's Cradle. If they're playing Cabal Coffers and Urborgs, then you can get all those abilities on your own without having to spend the mana of having those cards. This card is really good. It's a really good artifact that benefits you in a lot of different situations. Say if your opponents have a Field of Ruin or a Strip Mine, and you can essentially just use that as well. It's got a lot of potential, and the fact that it can just tap for any mana, essentially just a Chromatic Lantern. And this goes really good in Send Triplets, in 5-color decks, in decks where you're trying to copy spells or try to use your opponent's spells. I really like this card, and I definitely think you guys should pick up a copy of this right away.
Next up, we have the only other artifact that we're going to talk about with Twinning Staff. It costs 3 mana, and if you would copy a spell one or more times, instead copy it that many times plus an additional time. You may choose new targets for the additional copy. It also has an activated ability that says pay 7 and tap this artifact. Copy target instant or sorcery you control. You may choose new targets for the copy. This card is super unique. I don't think we have an artifact or any permanent for that matter right now, besides Kalamax. He just came out and he's a creature. But we don't have a lot of permanents that just let you for free basically copy spells. When I say for free is, of course you can pay the 7 mana and copy a spell, but if you're already playing a spell copy deck, this essentially when it's on the battlefield will add another copy to whatever you're trying to do. I probably wouldn't play this in any deck that's playing a lot of spells. I would only play this in a deck where the main focus is copying spells already, in a red, maybe like a red-blue Mizzix deck, or if you're being a degenerate combo player like me and you want to be playing a lot of combo copy spells, like a Dualcaster Mage or a Narumea copy deck, this is a super great include. I don't think that it's worth playing in a deck if you're just looking to pay 7 mana to tap it and copy a spell. That's probably way too much mana to do that. But it is very, very, very powerful in the decks that it does belong in.
And then last off, we have the new land from the Commander decks. It's Nesting Ground. It taps for a colorless, and for 1 and tap, move a counter from target permanent you control onto another target permanent. Activate this ability only anytime you can cast a sorcery. So there's a lot of decks that are going to want a land like this. It's kind of like a Karn's Bastion feeling to it, where you can use this to move counters when you've proliferated. If you've got super friends, you can move counters from planeswalkers, especially with the new keyword counters. You can move a hexproof counter from one creature to another, or an indestructible from one creature to another. There's a lot of utility with Nesting Grounds, and it's gonna be a really good land to include in decks that you're playing a lot of counters.
And with that, this episode's coming to a close. Thank you guys so much for sticking around this long and hear us talk about all these Magic cards. Stay tuned for our set review for the standard set, which will be released probably in the next couple of weeks, depending on when this episode comes out. We're gonna have a lot to say about a lot of cards in the standard set. A lot of cards in the standard set seem to be almost more commander playable than some of the cards in the commander set. We're super excited to be bringing you this content, and if you enjoy this content and you're looking for a quick, easy way of supporting our channel, feel free to subscribe to us, like this video, share it with your friends that are maybe new to commander or interested in building a commander deck. We're also going to be doing a lot of deck techs. We're going to be doing deck techs and upgrade videos on most of the commanders from this set, and deck techs on most of the commanders from the standard set as well. So you have that to look forward to as well.
Once again, a big shout out to Game Grid for sponsoring this podcast. If you're in Utah County, please check them out. We'll have a link in the show notes where you can go to their website and check them out. All right, guys, that's it for today. Stay safe and we'll see you later.
Did you see, I love all the foxes.
They're so cute.
Did you see this one?
That is so freaking cute.
I know. And the colorless one is adorable. That one.
Oh my gosh.
It's so cute. I'm not an animal person by any means.
But, and even the...
But
the
foxes. Oh, and the commander too.
Yeah, the... what is his name?
Zirda.
Zirda. Super like, cute.
It's Ninetale.
Okay. Even Lutri is really cute.
The otter?
Yeah. Okay, we'll stop fangirling about how cute these creatures are.